Hey y'all, my name is Prashanth Kumar, or PK, and I'm an MCAT tutor at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. Today, we're going to be doing an MCAT bio passage walkthrough, so you can see exactly what's going on in my head as I take on this section. You should be taking roughly 6.5 minutes on each of these passages, but we're going to be going more in depth today so you can see exactly what tips, what strategies, and what's going on as I take on this section. Let's get it. All right, so I've gone ahead and put the passage on the left and the questions on the right. So feel free to take a moment and pause the video and come back to us. If not, let's get right into it. First, let's talk strategy. We need to have a game plan going into any passage. Regardless of whether it's easy or hard, this should be something we come to at the beginning of any passage as we start it. For me, that's reading the paragraph, writing 3 to 5 word summary, asking myself what's going on, and then going on to the next paragraph. Doing this gives me a quick check-in at each paragraph end and make sure I'm reading for content, not just words. I often found myself reading all the way till the end of the passage and then having to stop and come back to read all over again. And this is a huge time drain on the MCAT. So let's get right into it and start practicing this. So the first thing is, the pituitary gland works closely with the hypothalamus to regulate homeostasis, metabolism, reproduction, and growth in multiple target organs. The pituitary gland is separated into the adenohypophysis and neurohypophysis, known as the anterior and posterior lobes, respectively. The anterior pituitary secretes 5 distinct types of hormones: somatotropes, HGH, lactotropes, PRL or prolactin, thyrotropes, TSH, corticotropes, ACTH, and gonadotropes, FSH and LH. So the question I continuously ask myself is, what's happening? And for me, that's just anterior pituitary releases 5 hormones. So quick 3 to 5 word summary, nothing too in depth. We just want to have this as like a roadmap, making sure we understand. We're not worried about details here. But let's go on to the next paragraph. Pituitary organogenesis and hormone synthesis is a complex process that is not completely understood. Many different transcription factors are temporally and spatially regulated. PIT1, for example, is required for pituitary cell differentiation, and the PIT1 gene has been implicated in growth hormone, TSH, and prolactin deficiency. So here we're asking the same question. What's happening? And oftentimes we struggle with this because it's complicated, there's a lot of details. So I like to use the first sentence as a sort of a topic sentence or a guiding sentence. And so it's just saying pituitary genesis equals complex, right? That's all it's saying. It gives us this detail about PIT1 required for cell differentiation and what hormones it's involved in, right? But here I'm just gonna say this is a roadmap, so we're not focusing on the details. Next. In a recent study, scientists have discovered a transcription factor, ZBTB20, that could play a key role in anterior pituitary development and lactotrope specification in mice. ZBTB20 is a zinc finger protein that contains BTB-POZ domains and C2H2 crupple type zinc fingers. So a lot of details right there. We're not worried about it. What is the main idea? It's this. I'll just write Z20 equals anterior pituitary development, okay? And so this is really how I write it, right? It doesn't matter if anyone else understands it. It doesn't have to be the most detailed thing. I like to use simple words, abbreviations, symbols. Really makes me save time. And at the end of the day, if you understand it, it doesn't really matter who else understands it. All right, let's go on to the next one. To further characterize the role of ZBTB20 in anterior pituitary development, scientists performed a knockout experiment in mice. ZBTB20 global knockout mice were bred and their phenotypes characterized. Hypopituitarism was found to be a result of the ZBTB20 knockout. Further results of this study are presented in figure 1. So here we have a study. And so what type of study is it? It's a knockout experiment. And this results in what? Hypopituitarism. I'll just write hypopit. But I'm just saying, when we knock this out, we result in this deficiency. All right, so next, we have a figure. And I don't like to spend too much time on figures, maybe just focusing on the x-axis or the y-axis, because that gives us an independent and dependent variable. We see age in weeks and body weight. And so I'm not even gonna spend too much time on that, because we don't know what questions will be asked, if any, about this. And so it doesn't make sense to spend too much time on something we don't really know. So let's go on to the next paragraph. Researchers followed the mice throughout their lifespan. At postnatal day 21, or P21, scientists perform ELISA experiments to analyze anterior pituitary hormonal contents in both wild type and knockout mice. The results are presented in figure 2. Okay, so this is just experiment 2 equals AP hormone contents. Okay, so that's all I really worry about. I'm not even going to worry about the details again. We see these graphs. This is an ELISA experiment, so we should have something going in our head, but we're not going to worry about it until we get to the questions themselves. All right, great. So now we're ready to go right into questions. And so I'll start with question number 1. I'll put it right here. Suppose a patient presents unregulated oversecretion of thyrotropes from the anterior pituitary. Which of the following symptoms is this patient most likely to experience? All right, so right away, I like to think about what exactly is the main thing, right? Oversecretion of thyrotropes, pretty important. And then we're looking at symptoms, what's exactly gonna happen. So first, that requires us to understand what thyrotropes are. And this was mentioned early in the first paragraph, right? We see thyrotropes mentioned with TSH. What is TSH? Well, this should be something covered in our content review. Thyroid stimulating hormone. So I'll write TSH equals thyroid stimulating hormone, right? And what does this do? Well, this directly results in T3 and T4. So these are very important hormones. And so we have to ask ourselves, what does T3 and what does T4 do? This is a question of understanding of a prior thing. And so what does it do? Well, T3 and T4 are metabolism hormones. If we have increased T3 and T4, we expect to have higher levels of our basal metabolic rate. So we're gonna write this results in increased metabolism. Okay, and so now we have to look at our answer choices and think, what does increased metabolism lead to? Does it lead to weight loss? That looks like a great answer. So I'm gonna leave that for now, right? Increased weight loss is a result of we're working out, we're doing all this, right? We'd expect weight loss if we have an increased metabolism. Vasodilation of heart and lungs, that doesn't really make sense just from thyroid stimulating hormone and an increased basal rate. Increased sex hormone levels, that's not really associated with that. That's more associated with sort of gonadotropin, the gonadotrope. So that's where we cross out. Gigantism, not really associated with this, probably more growth hormone associated. So we're gonna cross that out as well. We're gonna stick with A, weight loss, and already we're 1 for 1. Great work. All right, so let's go on to question 2. Abnormal levels of which hormone most likely explains the result shown in figure 1? A, ACTH, B, prolactin, C, TSH, and D, HGH. All right, so this is a question where it really tells us where we have to go back to, and we have to go back to that figure 1, right? So it says it right here, so we're gonna go right here. And so we're looking for what's significantly different between sort of this knockout mouse group and this normal group. And so if we look at the passage itself, it says hypopituitarism was found to be a result of the ZBTB20 knockout, right? So that's less hormones, hypo means less hormones secreted from the pituitary. And so we are seeing what? Well, we have age and we have body weight. Independent variable is age, dependent is body weight. So we're seeing a significant change in weight between the knockout group and the normal group, right? The normal group sort of increases at this steady pace, right? And it follows this upward path. Whereas this knockout group sort of goes, increases a little bit and then flatlines, it plateaus. So right away, we notice a very different pattern, and this is supported by these stars. And what do these stars show? Statistical significance, right? And so right away, we realize, okay, we are looking at statistically significant amounts of weight difference between this knockout group and this normal group, right? And so we're looking for hormones that would be attributed to that. Okay, and remember, this is hypopituitarism. So we're gonna have a decrease in the amount of hormone released, resulting in decreased weight for knockout group. Okay? So decreased amount of this hormone from hyperpituitarism results in decreased weight. So right away, let's start eliminating, because that's always so super helpful too. Prolactin is not associated with weight, it's associated with milk production. So we're gonna cross that out first. Well, what is ACTH? Adrenocorticotropin hormone is more related to stress and cortisol levels. So we're gonna cross that out as well. So now we have HGH and TSH. And so we just talked about TSH, but we're saying a decrease in amount of TSH would result in what? A decrease in amount of TSH would result in decreased T3 and D4, which result in less basal metabolic rate, which would be an increase in body weight, not a decrease. So right away, we see decrease would result in an increase in body weight. And so we can cross this out, right? Whereas HGH, if we had a decrease in the amount of human growth hormone available, then we'd expect a decrease in body weight. And that's why D is our answer. Really eliminating these first answer choices helps us get to this one, right? We might have been confused between TSH and HGH, but using this and getting down to those answer choices and then using the passage to help us guide us really helps eliminate TSH, prolactin, and ACTH, and leaves us with D. Great, we're 2 for 2. All right, let's go on to question 3. Which of the following hormones are secreted by the neurohypophysis? A, epinephrine, B, oxytocin, C, progesterone, and D, aldosterone. All right, so this can be a scary word, neurohypophysis. But we remember reading that somewhere in the passage before. So we're gonna go back just because we might not know what that means on first read. And so where is that? Well, that's right in the first paragraph. We have neurohypophysis, known as the posterior lobe, right? And then we have adenohypophysis, put it in green, is known as the anterior, but we don't really need that here. So we're looking for hormones secreted by the posterior lobe of the pituitary gland. So posterior lobe. So this is a super helpful time to focus on these hormones because these two are very, very important. The pituitary gland is one of the most important secretors of hormones, and it's important to have an understanding of what does what. So posterior, we have to use oxytocin and vasopressin. Those are the ones released. Vasopressin is also called ADH. So you might see that. Anterior lobe, there's a very helpful mnemonic called flat peg. I won't go into it now, but feel free to look up this mnemonic in anterior pituitary gland on the Shemmassian website and it'll come up. But this is a very helpful mnemonic to go through all of the anterior lobe hormones. All right, so right away with this piece of information, we don't even need to look back into the passage anymore. We see oxytocin. That is our hormone that's released from the posterior lobe of the pituitary. But let's go through the other ones. Where is epinephrine released from? This is released from the adrenal gland, specifically the adrenal medulla. What about progesterone? Well, progesterone is one secreted by the gonads. And finally, where is aldosterone? Well, aldosterone is also from the adrenal gland, but it's from the cortex, not the medulla. So right away, having this piece of information are very important for the MCAT, especially when you're dealing with what do hormones do, where are they coming from. Now, having this understanding, perfect. And so we are 3 for 3. And right on to question 4, our final question. Which of the following conclusions can be drawn from figure 2? A, ZBTB20 knockout leads to decreased production in all hormones from the anterior pituitary. B, ZBTB20 knockout has little to no effect on mice. C, ZBTB20 knockout leads to severe defect of lactotropes. D, D, ZBTB20 is necessary for anterior pituitary organogenesis. All right, so we have to look at figure two. And this is something directly stated by the question, so we're going right back. And we see five graphs. This can be overwhelming at first, but we really are trying to focus on what is happening in the bigger picture and use that to eliminate answer choices. So let's just take a look, right? On the x-axis, we have sort of this normal group and this knockout group again, right? I'm gonna put normal and knockout, right? Plus plus versus minus minus. And we are looking on the y-axis and we have growth hormone, PRL, TSH, ACTH, LH, right? We have these hormones and this amount released by the pituitary, right? And so this is what we're looking at. We're looking at two different types of mice and the hormones they release. And so having this big picture understanding allows us to understand what is going on, right? What is the difference between these two mice? Is there a difference? And so usually I love to just look for stars. That's the first thing I like to do. Stargazing, basically. And we're looking for that statistical significance. And that automatically can show that there is differences happening between this knockout and normal groups. And so right away, we can eliminate B, right? Little to no effect on mice. There are significant differences between this normal and knockout group. And so we leave that. But is there significance in these three choices? No, we don't see stars. We can only say something's happening if there's statistical significant evidence for that. And so we can eliminate answer choice A, because answer choice A says, oh, it's decreased production for all hormones. And that's not true. TSH, LH, and ACTH all show that there's no increase. So now we're left with ZBTB20, knockout leads to severe defect of lactotropes, and ZBTB20 is necessary for anterior pituitary organogenesis. So again, we're using these words like lactotropes, right? And lactotropes, when did it say up here, right? It is PRL or prolactin. So we're specifically looking at the prolactin column. Okay, great. So we are looking for prolactin, and that's right here. And we see there is a significant decrease in the amount of PRL compared to our normal or control group. And so C has support for its answer. So we're gonna circle that. Let's just check D too. ZBTB20 is necessary for anterior pituitary organogenesis. Is this true? Well, this isn't exactly true, as the hormones are still produced in equal quantities for three of the five hormones. While it won't be exactly, it's not necessary. So necessary is an extreme word, and we see that it's not necessary for three of the five hormones. So we gotta be careful with that, and we generally wanna stay away from extreme answer choices. So C is the best supported answer, and there we have it. We're 4 for 4. All right, great work, team. We knocked out a lovely bio passage dealing with hormones, the anterior and posterior pituitary gland, and some experimental design. Great work. If you like this video, give it a like and subscribe down below. Make sure to check out our 528 series to get a checkup on all the strategies that can help you get to your dream score. And click the link in our bio to sign up for the MCAT question of the day so you don't miss out on any practice from now until test day. Happy studying.